Dr. Mohammad, welcome to Let the Quran Speak.
Thank you for having me.
So, Dr. Mohammad, how has COVID impacted autism, like autistic kids and autistic parents, families that are dealing with autism? How has it impacted them?
So that's a really good question. And I'd say that it's impacted them in a significant way. And you know, for many children who are on the autism spectrum and their families and caregivers, the changes in job commitments, the changes in school and not being able to go to school, the shutdown of lots of therapy centers, mm-hmm. all of that has had a significant impact on children and youth, partly because it's disrupted routine, mm-hmm. right? We find that children who are on the autism spectrum often benefit from having a structured routine. And suddenly, you know, at least at the start of the pandemic, that routine had been significantly disrupted. Mm-hmm. And so often the advice that we were giving families at that point was to try in some capacity to create a new routine or a new normal. And as the pandemic has evolved, I'd say that many families have been trying hard to do that. It's not easy. And certainly, you know, there's been so many changes day to day. The other thing that's happening is that as things are starting to open up, there's some opportunity again to creatively modify that routine again. Mm-hmm. And so many therapists are now providing therapy through virtual means, using online technologies like Zoom, for instance. And so that gives itself, gives the family to establish a little bit more normalcy, fully recognizing that this isn't, you know, how things used to be 5 months ago.
Mm-hmm. Do you see that children are struggling, perhaps regressing because they're not getting the treatment that they need?
Yeah, I'd say that, you know, there's probably been a level of plateauing in skills okay. for a number of families, for a number of children and youth. Mm-hmm. And that plateauing has been, as a result of these changes. Regression or kind of them, you know, losing skills can also happen, right? Mm-hmm. Because a lot of what happens in child development is that children develop by practicing skills. And so if those opportunities aren't there to practice skills, whether it's academic skills or social skills or play skills, that can create, obviously, challenges, right? And their ability to maintain consistency. And so I would say that, yes, from a development point of view, I've heard that from families. I've also heard that parents have had an opportunity to observe their kids more closely. Because oftentimes parents might be at work or other commitments like their own studies, being at home has given them a chance to see what their child is able to do. Mm-hmm. And that's been really interesting to hear because that lens that families look at things through often might be through a therapy lens or a school lens, but they've been able to do that, you know, more kind of, I'm here at home with my kid, let's see, you know, if I challenge them this way or in another, what might they be able to do, which may not be something that they had seen before. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Mohammad, you spoke about the opportunities that parents have, but what about the challenges? How difficult has it been for them to cope during COVID?
So I'd say that it's been a balancing act, right, for them. They have shown a lot of resilience as part of the experiences that they're having. But I think one of the biggest things that I've heard is that for a parent to take on the role of a parent, a teacher, potentially a therapist, the combination of that has really created an added level of stress, right? And at the same time, children in more contained environments like the home might be showing more behavioral issues that require some added attention. I think that that's been one of the really key points and key messages that I've heard from families, that they've been trying. They've been trying to make do with the resources and the supports that they have, but it's been difficult. And obviously the experience of every family is going to be a little bit different, right, mm-hmm. In terms of what their specific experience is. But at the same time, the thing that's been cool and interesting to hear has been that because parents are at home, they're able to, you know, observe their child, as I was mentioning, and that gives them an increased awareness of how their child is, what their child is able to do, and what might that mean for that child in the future, right? Because parents are getting this nuanced look of their kid that they may not have been doing previously.
Mm-hmm. As things open up, you know, restaurants are opening, people are going to malls, people are starting to go to school in September, hopefully. What sort of challenges or opportunities would that pose to a child who has autism?
So, again, really good question. I think from my perspective and from what I've been hearing is that, again, it's a shift in routine, right? And so suddenly as things up until this point, we were at home, we were sort of more in a contained environment during quarantine, and now we're expected or allowed to go back, mm-hmm. That changes the routine again. And I think anytime there's a change in routine that poses a risk potentially to the child in terms of their adaptability to that. So I think families have to be preemptive of that and sort of anticipate anticipate what that, you know, transition is going to look like. Mm-hmm. The biggest transition that's coming up is one around school reopening. And there's lots of heavy conversations that families are likely having at this point about, you know, decisions to go back to school, what that's going to mean in terms of that child's schoolings, and what's going to be put into place for that child to be functioning within that school environment. Mm-hmm. Certainly children with special needs have added, you know, requirements. And is the school going to be ready to provide that type of support and resource? So my recommendation has usually been in that situation to have that conversation with the school up front. Like, what is that going to look like? There's also that added kind of consideration around masks, right?
I was going to ask you that, you know, would it be easy for a child with autism? Of course, you know, there are all sorts of children with autism, and it, you know, it depends on how serious it is for them.
Yeah.
But are there considerations around the mask?
Absolutely. And, you know, if we use the city of Toronto as an example, you know, a number of exemptions have been made, right? Mm-hmm. Age cutoff is one, so where children less than two, you know, don't need to be wearing masks just because of risks of suffocation and so on and so forth. But there's also a recognition that individuals with certain medical, mental health, or cognitive conditions may be exempt, right? Mm-hmm. And I think there is a recognition of that, particularly if that individual also relies on the support of somebody else to put the mask on. We have lots to learn, right? And one of the recommendations that we've been talking about in our field is to just get children practicing. And certainly children with autism, because they may have sensory differences, may be averse to having something over their mouth. And that, I think, people have thought about. Mm-hmm. And what that means when they enter into the classroom setting or enter into other environments, obviously, I've often said that the last 4 months have given us an opportunity to do a lot of practice about safe, you know, infection control practices, social distancing being an example, hand washing being an example. So all of those things we have to continue, realizing that we're going to be more in contact with people, and that people at the public health level are thinking about this and are trying to ensure everybody's safety.
Do you think that people in public health need to put more, let's say, funding, more resources into people with autism, especially as it relates to COVID and the reopening?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And I think the answer to that question is always yes, right? and partly because we know that historically, individuals with special needs or neurodevelopmental conditions are often under-resourced, right? And I think our awareness of the fact that these are people who are in our society, who are in our environments, in schools, and are our colleagues in certain circumstances, we do have to think about, you know, the functioning and the support to help with their functioning, both from a public health perspective, but I'd say across other avenues as well, right? Within the education system, within the healthcare system, in my own practice, I think these are absolutely important considerations.
Dr. Mohammed, you're doing really important work. Thank you so much for joining us today, and hopefully we'll have you back again.
Thank you for having me.